webcasting for a worldwide audience.
So anyway, Les Paul, and you know, when you're in the business of music, which I kind of vaguely am, sometimes the conversation gets around to, you know, great guitar players and the Jeff Becks and the Jimmy Pages and the Claptons, and I always say Les Paul. And they go, oh, it's a wonderful guitar, Les Paul. And I go, no, Les Paul. So there you go. It's 1950 in America, and post-war, everything's on the up. I mean, they beat Hitler by allowing him to knock himself out on the Russians and the British, and then pop in at the end just to deliver the knockout blow. Then they made a deal with all the Nazi scientists that had created the V2 and started a fantastic space program. A couple of years earlier, they'd defeated Emperor Hirohito by dropping atomic bombs, two of them, on Japan. America was a wonderful place. If you were white, if you were talented and you had a can-do attitude, and that was Les Paul. And here he is again.
I'm confessing that I love you.
By the way, that's his missus singing, Mary Ford. What a voice.
I'm confessing that I need you. Honest, I do need you every moment. In your eyes I read such strange things, but your lips deny they're true. Really change things, making me blue. I'm afraid someday you'll leave me, saying, can't we still be friends? If you go, all in life on you depends. noticing that you love me, dreaming dreams of you in vain. I'm confessing that I love you over again.
So Les Ball. Les Paul was born Lester William Paulsfoss, and he was born on June the 19th, 1959. By the time we get to 1947, and it's post-war America, Les is full of it. I mean, he's played with country acts, he's played with jazz acts. During the war, he hooked up with Bing Crosby and played for Bing and made a hit record with Bing Crosby. And he backed up the Andrews Sisters, who were a huge act. So Les was already a big part of the American guitar scene. And then his mother sort of ruined everything because she said to him, I heard you on the radio the other day, you were very good. And Les said, I didn't do the radio the other day. It was another guitar player. His mother had mistaken him for another guitar player, which really irritated him. And he set about to make his own sound. And to do that was very, very complex in those days. He had to single-handedly invent multi-track recording. And we'll get on to how he did that and how he also sold that to people. But anyway, 1947, he's made these very interesting records where he's overdubbed lots of guitars in a way that no one has ever heard before. And the science fiction writer, Isaac Asimov, said, superior technology is indistinguishable from magic. So this is magic. This is his first release as Les Paul, the multi-guitar man. It's called Lover.
Thank you.
Wow. So that sells over a million records. Instrumental record. Nobody ever heard the sound before. Before that, Les had been making records with Decca. And once he came up with this multi-track, magical, overdubbed, fantastic sound with pitching effects, with flanging effects, with all the stuff that's now standard in recording industry, he took them to Decca and they said, I'm not really interested. It'll sound like novelty records. And what happened next could only possibly happen to someone like Les Paul, and maybe only around that time when things were just not quite as organized as nowadays. These are Les's words I'm reading. About 5 or 6 one afternoon, I walked out the side door of NBC at the corner of Sunset and Vine in Los Angeles and saw a guy across the street putting up a canvas sign that said Capitol Records, brand new label. I had all these records in my hand, so I walked over and asked the people there who ran the place. And they said, well, have you got an appointment? I said, no. And then they said, you'll have to make one. So I hung outside. I saw everybody come out of the building at the end of the workday, and I just backed up the stairs. Inside was a door saying Vice President. And I walked in, and there was Jim Conklin. I said, hi. He said, I'm awful busy now. I have to run and catch a plane to New York. So I said, it'll only take a minute to listen to one of these. And Conklin asked me my name. And when I told him, he said, Les Paul, the guitar player. Yeah, I said. He pointed to a record player in the office and said, geez, I don't even know how to run that thing. Do you? I told him, yes. So he said, well, while I pack my suitcase, play one of the records. He listened and then said, Christ, how many of these things do you have? 22. The guy said, they all as good as that? Better, I said. I'm playing you the worst one right now. And Conklin said, man, get me a pencil. He found one and drew up a contract right there on an envelope. It said something like, as of now, you are signed with Capitol Records at such and such a percentage, with details to be worked out by the lawyer. But this is to confirm that we agree right as of now, and you may record in your own home studio as you wish. You now have a deal with Capitol Records. It happened that fast. Boy. Nothing like that happens nowadays. Anyway, so they put out the record, and it sells a million, and all of a sudden it's the Les Paul sound. But how do you explain this to people? Because it's complicated. And what I'm going to do now is also slightly complicated and inverted and very King Mob. I'm going to play you a radio show inside my radio show. Through the magic of tape, I'm going to play you a 15-minute radio show of Les Paul, which he did and recorded in his own studio, which was his garage in his home in Los Angeles, with his wife Mary Ford. And he's going to explain to you what a Les Paulverizer is. So over to Les.
Let's see, I've got my guitar, I got my wife, Mary.
Hi.
And I got a room just loaded with electronics. We've got some inventions here that make one voice sound like many voices and one guitar like many guitars. And by means of these 6L6s and plugging them into this amplifier, why, we managed to...
Let me tell him, Les, you're a genius.
Oh, don't embarrass me.
Oh, yes, you are. Anyone who can take one guitar and make it sound like six is a genius.
No, you just say that because I'm your husband. That isn't
true. No one else can even play like you, much less make it sound like six people.
Now, I like to play the guitar, but more than that, I like to get on the floor with a screwdriver and a lot of these gadgets and just tinker.
You're a genius.
No, I'm just a big tinker.
Okay, so you're just a big tinker.
Oh, I should have taken my screwdriver and left while I was ahead. How did I get swindled into this?
Well, why don't you grab a guitar and show the people what you can do?
All right, I got a lot of ideas. Here we go. Now that's one guitar. Now if you want two, I just throw a switch.
How about three?
Easy. Now if you want four, switch.
How about five?
It's a cinch. Now if you want six, here's a half a dozen easy ones. I got an idea. Now that I got six of them going, an arrangement made while you wait, Sweet Georgia Brown.
Real good, Les.
You like that, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Well, Mary, I've been thinking, what I did there, I made one guitar sound like six. I'm sure that with a little experimenting, I can make your one voice sound like six, too.
Huh. That's nothing. You eat like six.
No. How do I get into these things? That isn't what I meant.
Which reminds me.
Yes.
If you don't put that plug back in the electric stove,
well,
you're a dead duck.
I know, but I just wanted to connect the soldering iron.
I can't give anything but love if you don't.
Well, that's our... That's the cue for the next song.
I can't give you anything but love, baby. That's the only thing I've plenty of, baby. Dream a while, scheme a while, you're sure to find happiness, and I guess all those things you've always pined for. Gee, I'd like to see you looking swell, baby. Diamond bracelets, Woolworth doesn't sell, baby. Till that lucky day, you know darn well, baby, I can't give you anything but love. Gee, I'd like to
that was great.
Thank you.
Oh, rather, all six of you are great.
I'm all excited. I never knew you could make me sound like six people.
Oh, sure. This is just the beginning. I'm going to make you sound like 12 people.
I'm glad I'm really only one, though.
In a way, I am, too.
I'd hate to have five more husbands to worry about like you.
Say, and I'd hate to be saving up to buy fur coats for all you gals.
Les, I noticed some smoke coming out of one of your amplifiers over there.
I noticed it. I got to change some wires there. There's a strain on the equipment somewhere.
Just be sure you don't get the wires crossed like it did the other day, though.
Well, I don't know how that happened.
Can you imagine anyone getting the washing machine and the garbage disposal unit wires mixed up?
You gotta admit, it was the cleanest garbage in the neighborhood, though.
Here's Les playing just one old, ordinary, plain guitar on If I Had You. Les?
Yep?
I have a concert note for the listeners.
What's a concert note?
Well, just a little information that they give you about the artist at a concert.
That's interesting. Kind of fancy lingo like Mrs. Deems Taylor, huh?
I'd just like to mention that you played that last tune with just one hand.
Well, I was drying my fingernail polish on the other hand.
Oh, I'm serious.
Well, okay. I was cracking walnuts with the other hand because I like to eat when I work.
You're always kidding.
Well, I'm not interested in the guitar. The guitar is secondary. I got my mind on electronics. I want to make you sound like a big glee club and a mess of guitars. Oh, I got all kinds of... I tell you what, you sing something and I'll switch some wires in this box and we'll see what happens.
Baby, won't you please come home?
Now that's not what I want.
You left your mama all alone.
Well, that's better. I'm on the right track now.
I have tried in vain.
See, that's better. Now I'm going to make it sound like 10.
No more to call your name.
I guess I must have a loose wire. This has never happened before. I'm sorry, something isn't working right. I guess a wire fell off. I'll change it.
There, how's that?
Now you're three voices.
Well, I'll be doggone. Maybe I should have put this wire over here.
Is this any better?
No.
Gosh, now you sound like Arthur Godfrey, Mary.
What are you doing, Les?
I don't know, Mary. This thing is all messed up. Would you sing a chorus of Baby, Won't You Please Come Home, and I'll get on the floor here and see if I can test with it and straighten it out.
Okay. Baby, won't you
please
come home?
You left your mama all alone.
I have tried in vain.
No more to call your name.
What am I gonna do, Mary?
Fix it. When you left, you broke my heart. You said that we would never part. Any hour of the day, you can hear me say, baby, won't you please come home? I need some loving. Won't you please come home? What happened?
Mary, you better light a candle. I blew a fuse.
I'm going to do a radio show just like that. Anyway, so now Les and Mary have explained to you how the whole thing works with the Les Paulverizer. We can get all the technical stuff out of the way. Oh, except to mention that that's 1950. By 1957, Les had invented the 8-track recorder, which later became a recording standard. He had one in 1957. He took the design to Ampex and paid him $20,000. They made him an 8-track recorder and then patented it for themselves. but to give you an idea about time, Les Paul was using an 8-track recording unit in 1957. The Beatles' Sgt. Pepper is made on 4-track. The first time they used an 8-track was on one of my favorite albums, the White Album. So that's all the technique you're going to get. And now we're just going to enjoy the music of Les and Mary. And I'm going to play the B-side of his first big hit single, Lover, which is Brazil.
Thank you.
that's a B-side. But here's an A-side. Here's Les and Mary really giving it with Moving On.
That big eight-wheeler rolling down the track, meet your true love, and mama ain't coming back. I'm moving on, I'll soon be gone. You were flying too high for my little old sky. I'm moving on. That big loud whistle as a blue and blue said, hello, Alabama, we're coming to you. We're moving on, oh, you're my son. You had the life on me, so I've set you free, and I'm moving on. Mr. Engineer, take the throttle in hand. This ride is the best in stopping land. Keep moving on, keep rolling on. You're gonna ease my mind, so put me there on time. Keep it rolling on.
Yeah, and one of the Les Paul real features was take a song that's a well-known song or a well-known piece of music and just rip the thing apart in terms of arrangement, in terms of feel. And here's, I'm going to play you Moritat, which you will know better as Mac the Knife from the Threepenny Opera by Kurt Weill and Bertolt Brecht. And, oh, I love this. Yeah, well, Mac the Knife. Actually, I play sometimes a harmonica player called Peter Messer plays with me. Fantastic harmonica player. And Messer means knife, so I always think about Peter as Peter the knife, Mac the knife. Messer is knife in German. I spend time in Germany, you know, I'm a sophisticated, cosmopolitan kind of person, but my heart is in Lewes, in a bottle. I'm going to play Fire, which I really like, and Mary sings on this, and Les sings on this, and, you know, I have a whole lot of text quotes from Les and stuff. And again, it's one of those stories that could only happen back in the day when things just, people just seem to bump into each other and things just happened. Song is called Fire. I'm keeping my heart away from fire. And Les says, we were playing the Paramount in New York and our old friend Lou Levy, who was a really big music publisher, picked us up to go over to his home for dinner. Outside the Paramount stage door, a fellow walked up to us, said he'd written a song and began singing it. I just loved it and I bought it from him. Now, in those days, it's before the copyright laws, and you could just pay somebody for a song and then own it. So you could buy a song for like $50, and if it made $5,000 because you made it hit record, you made the $5,000. And Les continues, we had just started recording with a primitive 8-track machine, and Mary wondered how the hell I was going to arrange this song. And I wound up sitting at the piano with my favorite gold archtop prototype, Les Paul, around my neck, singing. It's the first and only record I ever made, solo or with Mary, where I did all three. When I designed the 8-track back in 53, I didn't have stereo in mind or anything like that. So when the console was eventually built, it was already in stereo. We could just throw a switch in a different direction to get either mono or stereo, perfectly mixed. So when stereo became popular, we didn't have to change anything. But until then, we continued using the 8-track as a mono machine to make mono masters. We originally put Fire out in mono, but here you're going to hear it in glorious stereo.
1, 2. Telefunken 5KC on its own box, all bass knocked out.
English mic minus French record.
English minus 4 in the bottom plus 10.
Go.
Take 2000.
My heart's been burned once.
Well, that's just a knockout. That's fire. And fire makes me think about smoke, and smoking makes me think about, you know, the 50s. Man, everybody was just smoking everywhere everybody went. I mean, sometimes two or three cigarettes at once. It was just wonderful. Here's Smoke Rings.
Tell me, where do they go? Those smoke rings I blow each night. What do they do? Those circles of blue. Why do they seem to picture a dream of love? Why do they fade my phantom parade of love? Puff.
Having a little debate in here about, you know, did I inadvertently or advertently there promote smoking? I don't know, really. I have mixed feelings. I've got to tell you, I still smoke cigarettes. Not as many as I used to. But I do still smoke, and someday I will give up.
Thank you.
I was lucky enough to see Les Paul play. Would probably be 99, and Mary had died. They divorced, actually, in 64, Les and Mary, because Mary did not want to continue performing, and Les tried to retire, but kind of guy he was, couldn't do it. But they stayed friends, and family was all cool. Les, after Mary died, Les moved to New York, and there he is in New York, and he's in his late 70s. He walks down the block, and there's a club called Fat Tuesdays, and he breezes inside, and he says, what's your weakest night? What's the lowest turnover? And the guy said, well, Monday nights, obviously. And Les just said, not anymore, because I play here now on a Monday night. And that's what he did up until he died. And the deal was he had a small trio. He really only had 5 of the 10 fingers working properly, but he was still excellent, really excellent and funny and witty. And I went in the company of Chris Spedding, who is not a bad guitar player himself. And Chris Spedding got up on stage and played with Les Paul. We missed the night before because Bob Dylan had been in, and that must have been fun. but anyway, Les Paul, here he is. You know, that's a very, very strange piece of music, using contrapuntal techniques and pitch shifting. That is worth listening to again. I'm not going to make you listen to it again, but it's worth listening to it again. Apart from seeing Les Paul, I always like to find things that I can relate to in these stories from my own personal life. So I've seen Les Paul, and that was great. But when I was doing music for TV commercials back in the early 90s, I got approached by the people who were doing Sugar Puffs, and they said, we're bringing back the Honey Monster, and we need a theme It's going to be like a big campaign. It's going to run for, you know, a number of years, and we're going to do a different ad each time, and the Honey Monster is going to do all this stuff, like with John Cooper Clarke, and it was all this. It was a refurbishment of the Honey Monster, and I went to the meeting, and they told me about this, and I was thinking, what the hell can we come up with? So I found the track Goofus by Les Paul, and I played that to the people, and I said, I'd like to do something kind of like that. And they said, oh, that's great. It's wacky. We pay you a lot of money. And I said, great. But then I got home, and I figured, how am I going to do this? How am I going to make, you know, I had a couple of guitar players, and they were good, but I mean, what I did, I kind of used the Les Paul technique, but I modernized it, and I took a load of guitaristic effects off a guitar and various notes, and then put them all on sampler and played them through a computer quite slowly, and then sped them up and messed them about. And boy, that Honey Monster campaign music ran for, I think, 4 or 5 years, and more or less built the house. Anyway, here's Goofus. Less is more, because we're nearly out of time, and this has just been so much fun. I hope you've enjoyed listening to Les Paul and Mary Ford, and thank you to Les and Mary for allowing us to use their posthumous radio show way in the future from when they did it in the past, which is already now the past, because tomorrow is another day, and next week there'll be another King Bob radio show about something. Anyway, but I'm going to finish now with Zydeco from Les Paul. Bless you, Les.
Thank you. jumping at this article. Don't be late to start at 8, really, I know. We do it upright every Saturday night, jumping at this article. Gonna kill a cow and butcher a sow, stop and get Aunt Lou. Buttermilk and pottery shaw, we're gonna have hog crackling too. Got her on the red bonnet with a green ribbon on it, and away we'll go. Gonna spend your money and have some fun, jumping at the Zydeco. Cow and butcher a sow, stop and get Aunt Lou. Buttermilk and a pottery shaw, we're gonna have hog crackling too. Got on the red bonnet with a green ribbon on it, and away we'll go. Gonna spend your money and have some fun, jumping at the Zydeco.
For a worldwide audience.